Hi, everyone. Today's session, we will focus on the gig economy and how learning and development has an impact due to that, how learning and development can make an impact to organizations. Just quickly, gig economy is basically a temporary work arrangement between individuals and a company. It's mainly short term. It's done mainly to get the advantages of cost, quality, and flexibility. There is a huge deal of autonomy in a gig economy. So Dr. Selvan, I was wondering, let's say, according to a McKinsey report, within the next 2 to 3 years, 20% of any workforce in any organization, large organizations, would comprise of such employees. How do you think a large organization can manage this workforce to ensure that business delivery by the same team is done on the same page? Everyone needs to know what needs to be done in the exact same manner.
Yeah. Thank you, Chandana. I think it's an interesting question, of course. So while you're saying that 20% might become the contractual type of employment, let me give you the situation today, how it is, because the way we look at it, it's almost like 100% are already in that mode, okay? Because the way, let's say, an organization like Capgemini works, you have the project managers who are stable. They have to execute projects. But the large development community that we have, they are fluid because they will just move into one project, complete that project, move on to the next project. So they are as good as a gig workforce. And it's our responsibility to see to it that the project managers' requirements of this moving workforce, the skills, what they have to know about the account, all of that is getting addressed. So the gig economy or that is more of a job market. That's more of a commercial model, I would say, which is how the organization wants to contract its workforce, whether they want to have flexi or whether they want to have permanency. But from a delivery perspective, and where L&D has to ensure that the customer commitment is honored, it is already a 100% gig workforce. And therefore, we do not see that there is going to be drastic change. However, there will be change because when there is permanency within the organization, you start investing more on capability building programs. You look at long term of that employee and do some sort of capability building. Whereas when you know that it's a very transient workforce, you start focusing more on what we call as the L4 skills. L4 skills are basically what you need to deploy on the particular project that you are there. And therefore, there will be a predominance of our focus on how do we develop L4 skills in a gig workforce compared to what we currently do, which is a combination of capability building and L4. So that's the difference that will come in play. Not much of a change, but definitely there will be change. That's my take on your question.
Thank you, Dr. Selvan. So I would assume that, Ishan, this question is more for you. Taking on from what Dr. Selvan said, there is, right now, today, there's a big focus on functional skills. So most L&D functions, most content curators focus on upskilling you functionally. However, do you think that will now shift to more managerial skills, how people can collaborate within team members? Do you think that would happen?
So, I mean, I first of all agree with Dr. Selvan that, you know, it's, I mean, gig economy is a business model. I think the mindset is already there. So it's there in IT services companies in the way that you have to go from project to project and you have to be trained for that. And then there are product companies where the 20-something year olds who are anyways earning thrice that they should be earning are anyways in a very giggy mode, right? I don't even call it gig economy. It's a very giggy mode that we're going to do whatever. We're here for a short time. We'll do something and then we'll figure out next thing, right? So companies have to anyways continuously make them feel committed. To your question, you know, I think they both go hand in hand, right? So the collaborate, the managerial collaboration is absolutely required, or, you know, collaborative attitude, how to work on projects together, how to work in different teams, right? I mean, consulting firms have been doing it for years. when people were joining, right? I mean, they literally have all those tests to know exactly which person will fit with which person and not, right? All the personality tests. But I think at the same time, we can't, I don't think we can put more credence on it than the technology skills itself, because at the core is still the technology skills that are required, which L&D functions are helping to fulfill, and the technologies are moving at such breakneck speed that if you don't do that basic stuff, everything else around it will fall. So our belief is still that you have to invest there, but of course, you need tools of collaboration and trainings to for people to be able to work collaboratively.
So clearly, Amit, there is a huge focus on how technology can enable this. Do you think that the product or service offering that LMSs or even any L&D partners provide, do you think that will change?
They have to change. You know, first of all, just kind of picking up from what Dr. Selvan and Ishan said, I would add that a gig economy is not just freelancers or part-timers. Today, it is actually about part-timers, short-timers, freelancers, and even flexible and mobile workers. So, you know, as you know, he rightly pointed out, it is already there in some way. But that is a small part of what is going to really happen in the future, where, you know, people will work from their home offices, their homes, you know, from various mobile zones, and also they will, you know, come in and go out very quickly of the company. So I think for in the context of learning culture, which is like, you know, in my view, defined by competence, knowledge, and performance as the keywords. So what the risk would be that while the competence could be built for even the gig workers, but the competence will go away when they go out. So the company will have to address the challenge where how do they retain the knowledge even though the people have moved out. So that is where I think technology can really play a big role, because, you know, if you have to just kind of use some words, like I think an open communication between everybody in the company, be a part-timer or a short-timer or a freelancer or a permanent worker, technology can really help in creating channels for open communication. The second would be integration of various work group mixes. You know, how do you make people work together who are having different objectives in mind? You know, somebody who comes in for 6 months or 1 year, or somebody's been there for about a few years, they all have different objectives when it comes to learning and performing. So how do you mix and match these and work on a common goal is going to be a challenge which I believe technology can solve to a large extent, because of course it is all driven by the people behind technology. But you know, having a platform which allows people to, for example, you know, from a session in the morning, Kimo's session, one of the keywords I picked up was reflection of individual learner, which is really important. But how do you retain the reflection of the learner beyond their time frame in the company? And how do you enable that collaboration with other reflections to create that knowledge pool? So I think technology can help in channel of communication, integration, interaction, and collaboration between various kind of learners. And today, learners are not just learners, they're also consumer learners. People are coming in for a short time, they're also, you know, they're consuming things and they're also learning things. But, you know, coming back to my, I think, key area is how do you retain the knowledge beyond just building competence? I think that is where technology can really help. You know, like say, for example, a very small example like XAPI, it goes beyond just e-learning. It goes into every activity you do. So you can use that to track beyond just the learning elements. You can use it to track your activities beyond learning elements. Also, you know, using competitiveness between the two various work group mixes, like, you know, for example, gamification in a learning system. You can create, because they both have different objectives, but you can create a common level of competitiveness to enhance, you know, the level of learning they need to deliver on the value and the output for the customer commitments.
But just to your point on how L&D partners have to change, right? I think there are four critical elements to that. I think first is micro-learning, ability to really, really have short spurts of learning as and required. I think second is N equal, what I like to call as N equal to one, where each learner is important. The times where you tell 100,000 learners that do this and you learn is gone. Like each learner is important and needs his or her outcome need to be delivered by the L&D partner. The third is ability to scale. So while we keep N equal to one, can we teach 2,000 people machine learning at one go, right? Because that's the kind of requirements that people like Dr. Selvan and challenges that they throw at us, right? Can we immediately do that? And then fourth is the ubiquity of the platforms, right? So on mobile, desktop, laptop, all of that should be happening at all the times. So I think those four elements, we have to evolve quickly from the older methods of delivery, and I think that is how we'll be able to survive over the next 2 years.
I think that's a very good way of summing up what the challenges would be. It's a good segue into what I wanted to ask. Bruce Lee once said, "I fear not the man who practiced 10,000 kicks, but I fear the man who has practiced one kick 10,000 times." So I wonder if we'll look for more specialists in the gig economy, and therefore, because employees would, organizations actually, would look for specialists to come in to perform that particular task, rather than generalists. Do you have anything to say on that?
I think absolutely. So we will be looking for specialists, very clearly segmented and very narrowly specified to the task. So the key thing is, how do we break down work into various tasks into skills, and then look for the profile of the people. So that exercise in a large scale is already going on in many of our organizations, so that we are able to adapt to this particular economy. So it is going to be skill-based, and in my feeling, assessments are going to become a very key role, especially when you go into narrowly defining skills. The readiness of a person, you're able to assess how quickly, not go through the conventional assessments, but adaptive assessments. So those are going to be some of the changes which will happen in terms of the skill requirement.
So that actually, I wonder if that would change the way talent management is managed, not just learning and development, but even the steps after that.
There would be a big change, because while we will look for specialists to come in from outside to work, there will be a larger pool of people who will be working to manage the entire team, not just for that project or for the customer, but for a longer term perspective. Now, these people need to have skills beyond these special skills. That is where the talent management, and again, making sure that everybody, be it a part-timer or a short-timer or a permanent employee, they are contributing to the learning culture in the company. It is very important for everybody to be clear of that. That is where learning leaders, and not just leaders, learning leaders, but also the managers at micro and macro level, they need to inculcate that, almost like a culture of seeking learning. And, you can have tools to enable and make it easy, like Ishan said, make it available on your mobile devices, anywhere you want to access, anytime you want to access. But talent management has to go beyond just performance management and making sure that things work fine. Because, in my view, there's a definite risk that the skills people will bring in and they will take them out with them. And what does remain with the company is what we have to really focus on. How do we retain the positive growth from that work we have done for the last 6 months or 9 months? How do we retain that so that next time we do it better than we've done last time? So I think the leaders, learning leaders and talent leaders have to really focus on that. And technology can, of course, always help. It has to, there is no other way out, because the scale, I think you have 100,000 employees, and out of that, 50% is distributed. Just an imagination we can put to use. It's going to be a big task by managing manually, so it has to be technology based.
I agree. I would sum it up as 2-3 things that I've taken away from this. One is the shift from capability building to L4 skills that need to be brought on. The second one is how to manage a team how to create a team which works well together, because that's not a permanent team that goes on, and how to retain the knowledge of these specialists who come in. So I think those are my takeaways. I'd love to hear from the audience what their takeaways are. If there are any questions, we can take them now.
Hi, thank you for the insight. One question in the spirit of diversity and inclusion, right? So we're talking about 20% of this global population that will move into the gig workforce. So if, as a policy formulation organization, how does one ensure that there is no discrepancy that is viewed in light of the other the other employees as well?
So I think the diversity policies will not change much, because equal opportunity is what we always provide. So the platform is going to be the same as long as the skills are available, and diversity is not just about the gender, but about a variety of other things. So the equal opportunity principle will be constantly maintained. It's not that is going to be diluted in any way because of this sort of a workforce coming into place.
And I think, an economy where more people working flexibly out of office or short time, it actually works better for diversity and inclusion because you don't have, there are no restrictions on you physically moving to a place of any gender. The focus is on skills and what you can do with those skills in that amount of time. So, you know, even a simple work from home policy in some companies make, you know, it does wonders with helping a lot of people work may not have been possible earlier, even though you have the right intent as a company. But I think this will actually enhance and make it better. And it might, you know, just turn the trends because, you know, I'm sure there are a lot of skills available in so many people we don't even interact with on a daily basis. So in my view, it will actually help have a better, diverse and, you know, more inclusive workplace.
I actually have an example on that. So Udacity works globally. We're based in India. We have offices in Brazil, China, Germany, US is our headquarters. We were working with the government of Egypt. And they wanted to teach technology, and they took out 500 scholarships. And that was an online version with a classroom setting. 80% were women, right? And it was mind-blowing. The picture is, of course, just like, you know, it's all women. It's mind-blowing technology picture, right? Because it doesn't happen in technology schools in India, right? And then we figured out why is that, right? So I sent out a question asking my Egyptian counterpart, what is happening? Like, this is awesome. We can't do this here ever. And his answer was exactly that, you know, because of this whole gig effect, freelancing effect, women can now figure, I mean, at least in that society, women could easily figure out work module that they could come and do, and then they'll go home and they'll work from home and they'll take gig jobs. So it just made a lot of sense for them to do it in that way.
So in fact, there's one thing I can actually say from most corporates who create policies for employees, and in their sense, an employee means a full-time employee. I believe that the study that McKinsey came out with showed that people move towards a gig economy, gigs mainly, because they want the flexibility, because they don't want to be bound by the policies of an organization. So they find it easier to deal with work on their own terms without having any policies. Having said that, organizations, on the other hand, will still need to make sure that they have infrastructure in place because you have firewalls that block access, you have emails that can or cannot be sent out, simple examples. But these will need to be re-looked into. So small things, not so much policies, but processes will need to be looked at to make it a little more inclusive. Any other questions? I believe there was.
So you talked about long-term capability building versus the L4 trainings that are required. My question was more oriented towards then how do organizations ensure engagement and loyalty in this kind of gig economy, if you can throw some light on that. How do we maintain loyalty and engagement with this kind of a diverse workforce?
Okay. I would say that we don't want it, right? Because then that's defeating the whole purpose of this economy, what we are looking at as a working model, right? It's not about loyalty, trying to build loyalty. It's about having flexibility, speed, agility, right skills at the right time. So those are the key drivers of this change in the economy. It's no more going to be that long-term loyalty factor which we'll be wanting to drive. Yeah. I think you had a question.
Hi. My question is, it's all fine, one employee working for one company, whether it's contract, part-time, work from home, whatever. In the future, we see that one employee could be working for multiple companies. How would you address L&D challenges then?
See, a simple way to look at it is from the company's perspective. So if I look at my interaction with the consultant or the person, you know, the focus has to be on what he or she is doing with me. And if we focus on that part, everything else is blurred out, and we can then put it back into our own context of how we are managing learning and talent management for our, everybody else we are working with. I think it'll be easier because if we keep looking at everything he or she is doing, we will have too many distractions to really focus on what, because what is important to us is what they are bringing to our table. So if we can manage to bring that back to our own context of how we are managing learning, it might be easier. It may not be easy, but it'll be easier.
So I'll just add to that. So work will be delivered through platforms. Work is not going to be done in offices where these experts are going to come, sit there and execute for your organizations. As long as they are able to log into a platform and then they sign in into one company, they will do that work for that company. When they sign in into the other company, they can do the work for that company. So the security aspects and the information security, what you require on the platform, they have to be robust to take care of this sharing. But otherwise, you have to trust the skill of that employee as long as they are delivering to you to the task that you have assigned on the platform, and as long as you're getting the output, you're fine with it. So it's a simple thing that task is given to a person on a platform, they execute it, they get the remuneration credited into their bank account immediately. So that's the economy that we are all moving into. How soon it will become mature, that's a question mark with everyone. There are some organizations who have taken a big lead. They have pioneered the platforms. They are testing it out on a large scale. Others are following up. So it will evolve over a period of time.
Hello, everyone. My name is Vandana. I work with Bharti AXA Life. Now, one of the risks that I foresee with this gig economy is that, you know, people come in and, with skills and competencies, but they are temporary in nature. Now, there could be a scenario where, suddenly there is a vacancy in this position and we do not have that competence available in the market. Then as an L&D professional, how do I ensure that in such times, my organization is ready with its internal competence to replace, these kind of positions?
Yeah, I think we're living in interesting times when technology is moving so fast that companies are frankly out of competence on some of the higher end technologies, right? And the only way to balance that is thinking ahead of time and almost overtraining. It sounds almost self-serving, but almost overtraining organization. I can tell you that in the last 2 weeks, we have gotten the same requirement from at least 5 IT services companies that they want to teach few thousand self-driving car engineers. Right? Same requirement. Cities are the same. It's Bangalore, it's Dallas, it's Detroit, it's Munich. And a little bit of Beijing, and that's what it is, right? And then they want to hire. And we're telling them you can't hire. Because literally India has less than 1,000 self-driving car or autonomous technologies engineers. To your point, so the companies are already on it because they know that they cannot, no gig economy will actually help them in this one because there are so few professionals. So it is all about, as I said, N equal to one at scale training that companies will have to do and almost overtrain, because the other problem of not having competence and suddenly building them is that you invest in the employee and then suddenly the next bigger, more glamorous brand will come and take them away, right? So you'll have to almost overtrain immediately. Again, as I said, it sounds self-serving, but that's what I feel is the situation right now, what we are hearing.
So I'll just add to that, the Vandana's question. So organizations have to move away from thinking that it is their responsibility to develop their employees to creating opportunities for self-directed learning so that the jobs, the tasks, everything is transparent, available. Like you already have the internal job portals which say that these are the opportunities. Along with that, if there is an environment for self-directed learning, your employees will learn, pick up that skill and see that so many jobs are available. Let me apply to them and get myself employable. So that's the model that you will have internally as well as outside. The same type of people will be competing for that job from outside. The question is the commercial model, whether you want to use your internal employee, is that better for you or an external employee? But from a learning perspective, it will become self-directed more than organizations wanting to push learning to employees.
Hello, everyone. We touched upon talent management and continuation to Vandana's question that, we are looking at specialist skills and we are not looking at a long-term perspective. Then how does it impact our leadership talent identification and leadership talent development? Because, for us, leadership is somebody, or a leadership talent is someone who is more like a generalist, who understands the various functions and can perform in the long run.
Generalists to koi jaati hi nahi hai. Matlab, generalists are there, like, to be honest, right? I mean, I'm an MBA by degree, but I mean, honestly, like, I wish I would go back and do a master's in artificial intelligence 10 years back, right? I mean, I believe that, of course, we require generalists, and generalists will continue to, to her earlier question, management skills, how to manage those diverse workforce, how to manage gig economies, generalists will have to learn all of that. But I think the real focus is the specialists, because those, I think we're moving, we have had pleasure of working with Dr. Selvan's team, and they're teaching a lot of people basic skills, but then suddenly, right on top of that, they're building a very, very specialist set of employees who will know what to do, and maybe they'll self-select into the system, but they'll still know what to do, right? So I think the world is all about getting, at least from my perspective, I feel it's about specialist skills more than generalists. I mean, few generalist managers will be there, but I don't think they are the ones in demand all that much.
Sure. I'll just add to that. So the core of the organization will be split into some cadres. Okay, those cadres are what you have. Like, for example, architects is a cadre. Architects, you might not be wanting to do through the gig economy. Or project managers or engagement managers are a cadre of people. Now, what you were asking about leadership development, you will invest in those cadres. But where you have large population of skills available in a free market economy, you will move towards the gig economy and then source them like that. So your strength as an organization is dependent on how good your cadres are. And that will define whether one organization is better or the other organization is better.
And just one small point to that is the new leaders have to learn skills of being able to manage the diverse team. Plus, I think they have to focus more on making sure there are enough processes in place and systems in place which enable to deliver experience to all of these people. Because, you know, linking back to that question we had on employee loyalty, is companies will have to create ecosystem which deliver experience, positive experience to everybody so that they can contribute more to. So I think the new leaders will have to learn skills to manage people from a different perspective. So it's not just about making sure there's a P&L happening properly. It's about everybody is working to their potential. Even though they move in and out, does not really matter, because what remains back is something positive.
With that, thank you for your time. Thank you for listening to us. It was a pleasure for us to speak with you guys. And we'll catch up with some of you guys offline. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Chandana. Thank you, everyone.